Welcome to Discussion Bound Book Group. Today is December the 8th. My name is Christy McMillan. I'm the Director of Learning and Engagement, and I'm joined by Barbara Pressman, touring docent, who is going to be moderating today's discussion. Today we are going to be discussing Clara and Mr. Tiffany by Susan Vreeland. It's been quite some time since I've read anything by Susan Vreeland, so this was a great treat. Thank you, Barbara, for suggesting the book. Before we get started, you probably noticed that your microphones and video were muted by default. If you choose to have your video on, please choose a quiet room and close the door, silence any alerts from nearby devices. Try not to sit in front of a window, lamp, or other strong source of light or motion, as it makes it hard to see you if you have on your video. Use headphones and a microphone for best sound quality. I'm going to have a little bit of a hard time hearing and speaking today because I don't have my microphone and headphones, but I'll do the best that I can. But luckily, Barbara P. is going to keep us on track today. While you can log in using a smartphone, we do recommend using a desktop, laptop, or tablet in order to see slides, meeting tools, and each other on a larger screen. Make sure that your screen name includes your first name and last name or first name and last initial so that we know who we're talking to. In order to ask questions and make comments throughout the program, you're welcome to unmute your microphone when Barbara or I ask for questions or comments. You can also type any questions or comments that you have into the chat box. A third way to participate is to raise your hand in the participant sidebar, and either Barbara or I will call on you and unmute your microphone. We are recording, so if you prefer not to be recorded, make sure that your video and audio remain muted and use the chat box to submit questions or comments. Barbara wanted to start us off with a little video. Did you still want to do that, Barbara? Oh, sorry, hold on. Make it so that everybody can unmute themselves. Okay.
I thought it would probably be a nice place to start because okay. I'm sure people are familiar with that, Tiffany, but I think it's so lovely.
Okay, let me get that started for you, Barbara.
And I love the choice of the music. It was really perfect.
We have two amazing docents who always choose music for our programs, and that was their choice. I think that they had a wonderful choice. It really got me in the mood for the time period and also the place. So let me start this video for you, Barbara.
It's actually in the book.
A New Light on Tiffany, Clara Driscoll and the Tiffany Girls, at the Albuquerque Museum of Art and History, organized by the New York Historical Society. This exhibition features the story of Clara Driscoll and the Women's Glass Cutting Department, who worked for Lewis Comfort Tiffany for the Tiffany Studios between the 1880s and about 1909. This exhibition describes her story and her influence in the women's glass cutting department, as well as her design inspiration as she worked closely with Louis Comfort Tiffany during the turn of the century. She and her sister Josephine first worked for the window and mosaic department at the Tiffany Studios, and there they cut small, brilliantly decorated pieces of iridescent glass for the windows and mosaics that the department made for Tiffany. This window, the Good Shepherd with Landscape, was built for a sanatorium in the Adirondacks, and it was designed by Frederick Wilson. But the glass was all cut and assembled by the Women's Glass Cutting Department. And it was believed at the time that the women had better accomplishments with selecting colors of glass and also had nimble fingers that could be used to cut out the small circular pieces of glass. This is Clara Driscoll's wisteria lamp. She worked very closely with Louis Comfort Tiffany to design this lamp. He really loved this plant and he had it all over his summer home. Clara Sarah's creative process for designing these lampshades were very interesting. It wasn't very often that changes were made to her designs, and particularly he really loved the dragonfly lampshades. They were made in a variety of colors and textures. This group of shades shows the range of subtle color variations that the women's glass cutting department could achieve. If you look at the far right, you can see the laburnum lamp and its beautiful sculpture of quality with its silhouetted rim showing the beautiful yellow flowers coming off the tree. In the other lamps, you can see the range of colors that were used for daffodil shades. And they're all very different. They're all very beautiful. Some show the stems radiating down with the flowers at the bottom. Others show the plants radiating up with the flowers at the top. All of them cut and selected by the Women's Glass Cutting Department. This detail of a larger window called the Four Seasons window won great acclaim at the Paris Exposition Universelle in 1900. Tiffany created multiple windows on the theme of the seasons, including this window with a female allegorical figure that is the allegory for spring. You'll notice that the glass that's used in here is a combination of street glass and fracture glass, and it was very popular. Please come visit the Albuquerque Museum, where we'll be exhibiting A New Light on Tiffany, Clara Driscoll and the Tiffany Girls, through August 21st.
That was wonderful. Thank you for choosing that, Barbara. I agree. Doris had put a note in the chat box to say, so great to actually see the work that was described in the book.
Yeah, that's why I wanted to show it, because I fell in love with Tiffany I've always heard about him, but in 1990, around then, I went to the Metropolitan Museum, and they were having an exposition of his glass of the large walls, and they were breathtaking. I have a poster that I framed, and it's hanging right here opposite me in my living room, and I drag it with me everywhere because it was so amazing. It can't be captured in a poster, but it reminds me of that memory. And so I was always attracted to Tiffany. But a friend of mine recommended this book because it was from the Arts and Crafts conference that's held here in Asheville. And she said, oh, Barbara, I know you love history and art, and you'll like this book. And I did. And there was even an added bonus. It was about New York City. And that was also very exciting for me because it reminded me of many places. And like you said, Susan Vreeland is a wonderful author. She, similar to me, loves art, loves literature. She was a literature major and then an educator for many years of her life. And she taught ceramics and literature. I'm not going to give you all the dates and all, but unfortunately, she got lymphoma and was forced to leave work. And during that time, she began to write. And I thought this was really nice in her biography. It said something that she wanted her friends, that it was not a reason to go on living, to complete the books or to write the books. It was a joy and happiness to be writing. So she found a great joy in her writing. She's very meticulous in her her research. And after reading this book, I read Saturday Afternoon at the Boathouse, which is about Renoir. So any of you that enjoy reading historical fiction will enjoy her. Because I think I went to a talk once and they said that sometimes historical fiction is just like set in the time and the person is not very true to the history. But I think that Susan Vreeland was very true to the history, and there are many characters that she mentions in the book, some of them just casually, who did have a tremendous influence on art and the development of art at the turn of the century. There was one woman that she just mentioned briefly who was considered the mother of American Impressionism. And she also talks about her name was, Susan Mitchell. Mitchell, her last name. And then she got married. She didn't want to get married too, because she didn't want to have to, her husband said that he would let her continue painting. So there is many people that are referred to in the book. As O. Henry is mentioned in the book. And there was this lady who was a decorator. I love that little quote, don't complain, don't explain, don't complain. And that is a real Elva Wolf was a decorator. And then there was another woman, Candace Wheeler, who also worked with Tiffany and is also mentioned at the Boston talk that that she gave. And she was the founder of the Arts and Crafts for Women. So there were many people, and she was, I think, pretty true to her her writing of the book. I know that she did know Edward George Waldo, and she was engaged to Edwin, and he did disappear. But it said he did, in one of the things I read, he said he came back 5 years later, but he never got in touch with her. So I don't know. That was a pretty dicey part of the book. Anyway, I have some questions for you. And did you have those questions? Okay, so my first one, and I thought this was also interesting. When we started Docent Training, we read the book American Art of the 20th and 21st Century, and it was about the Gilded Age. So do you think the author accurately portrayed the Gilded Age? Why or why not? And how did the events and World's Fair and accomplishment of that time lay the groundwork for American art? Does anybody have anything they would like to talk about?
Is the World's Fair in Chicago something that you all are familiar with before having read this book? It's called the White City.
No.
Yes.
Okay. Go ahead, Billy.
Well, because you know, we lived in Chicago for 15 years, and one of the highlights of Chicago is the dome at the Cultural Center, which formerly was the museum, the library that Tiffany created. But, and the White City talks about some of the competition of artists. So there's a lot of, you know, that age, the Gilded Age, in that age emerged so many artists, and the joining of French artists and American artists, I think, that had a strong impact as well. What do you think, Christy?
Yeah, absolutely. Go ahead, Sharon. Just feel free to unmute yourself whenever you'd like to jump in.
Well, I think that, yes, art was definitely taking off. But also with those expositions that were becoming so popular and millions were visiting, I think that the Gilded Age, with all the money and the extra resources that it had, there was just so much going on. And I think it gave a real flair to people to try brand new things. And certainly Tiffany's designs and those gorgeous pieces that he put out were not the usual. They were very, very much, you know, extraordinary things to be done in the art world. So I think the question is a good one, that the Gilded Age definitely came through in his art.
The Gilded Age also provided financial support. There was a lot of industrial wealth that was funneled into the artistic community because of the interest in arts, the merging of European and American art, and the building of so many of the wonderful museums that we have today as well.
Right, I think in what we learned at the about the Gilded Age, and especially the White City, a lot of it was imitation of the old world, but there was a lot of introduction of America and the new world and new artists, and you know, such as Comfort Tiffany Actually, I think they might have Marie Cassatt, some impressionist artists were there. And I think it was a way to publicize, since it wasn't television or radio or any other way that people learned about the arts and crafts. And so I thought that was important. I learned a lot from this book, and I thought that was important in it.
Pat and Mike?
Yeah, I have a question. In the book, he talked about 1,500 millionaires to sell all the stuff he was creating and all these other people moving from the Midwest to New York. And what I'm wondering is the people who collected the art and supported the art, all these new millionaires, were they really, do they know about art, or were they simply trying to be like everyone else and have art in their houses?
I think that's a really good question, Pat, because I really think that one of the things that I think they try to point out in the book, that is they were trying to commercialize art, make it a more decorative arts, and making art more affordable or available to people. And on whether or not, I mean, I guess that's a question of is it style versus art? I personally think that the Tiffany windows and lamps are art. To me, they are. I don't know how the millionaires viewed it. I don't know. Does anybody else have any idea? I might have just been the thing to have.
Well, don't you think that the wealth, particularly in the major cities, and that would at that time was New York, Chicago, Detroit, and St. Louis also had a lot of money as well. But the women during that age who were married to these wealthy people were interested. That was one of their activities, was to become involved in the arts. And that's when, like, the Antiquarians at the Art Institute in Chicago was formed. And it was fueled by the interest of women. There were literary organizations. I can't think of the one in Chicago that I belong to. but there were literary organizations that were started. And so the funding of all of this came through the women and it was interesting to me to read about this and think, and Mary Cassatt had some of the same struggles. Women weren't accepted as artists. And so, and the control that you hear of women that men had during that era.
Well, actually that's, Sharon, go ahead.
Oh, a good question, Mike. I think also at that time, like the last speaker just said too, there was an interest, and it was certainly helped by the fact that these wealthy people had agents all over the world shopping for them. Mm-hmm. Whenever a palace was destroyed in England, you know, the fireplaces, the doorknobs, everything was sold and considered, you know, that quality, whatever the quality was of the individual pieces. So I think that, I don't know how much the actual person with all the money building a palace here in America doing the buying was informed about it, but I think they did learn a lot through these agents who were certainly very knowledgeable about antiquities and the art world in Europe.
Mm-hmm. I'm just thinking of the Cohn sisters, and a lot of what they did was really to be patrons for a lot of these artists. I think they came maybe a little bit before this time. I don't know if they're really part of the Gilded Age technically, but they were around that period and were great collectors of modern art.
Exactly, right.
Well, I think it laid the groundwork for an American market and for the development of American art. I thought so. And I think Billy's point is really my next question. What do you think it would have been like to live in the Gilded Age for a woman, especially an artist? And what were the expectations and limitations of women at that time, and how did Clara fit the mold, but also find her own way? Do you think things have changed for women in the arts? I certainly hope so.
I was really struck by, I think this goes to your first question and your second question, but that extreme difference between the have and the have nots. So mm-hmm. we're talking about these young women, you know, who started as teenagers, specifically so that they could work longer before they got married. And they were making, you know, $3, $4, $5, $6 a week, but these lamps were selling for $500 and $600. And when I'm thinking about, you know, what it takes to get by on $350 a week or something, yet these lamps can go for two times, you know, somebody's annual salary, it kind of stopped me in my tracks. Another thing that I think speaks to your second question was when the men went on strike against the women, and the women just wanted to go to work. And people were telling them, you know, you should be supported by your father or your brother or your husband or a male, not working for yourself. And I was thinking about some of the women that were working with Clara and Clara herself that didn't have men to depend on. So what is that dichotomy of you should be depending on a man, but you don't have a man in your life to depend on? So it made me think that there were probably a lot of people in a really impossible situation where, you know, I can see very easily where people would get caught up in this cycle of poverty or, you know, destitution if they weren't mm-hmm. afforded the opportunity to support themselves.
Well, there were very few opportunities for women to support themselves. And, okay, go ahead, Sharon.
Oh, okay. Well, one of the problems with that was if you were an unmarried woman, or in Claire's case where her husband Francis died and didn't happen to leave her what he had, he gave it to a daughter. If you were got married, you also got fired. So that was difficult because you'd have to think about, you know, well, if I hope this marriage works out, otherwise the employment that she just had would be also gone at that time.
But not just for the arts, but for teachers.
We're not married.
And that really didn't change for a long time, because when I first started working in the early 70s for a in an industry in a utility company, I just asked someone one time why all the women, the only women that were there at the time primarily were in clerical positions. And when you looked at like the executive secretaries, I said, why are they all Miss so-and-so? And one of my colleagues at work said that because right up until the 60s, married women, once they got married, would have to leave, or they wouldn't hire married women because they thought that the men coming back from World War II were the ones that needed a job. And so the only ones that survived in that company at that time were ones that never married. And so that wasn't all that long ago, you know, considering.
But one of those aspects, the important aspect of that date was that's when the pill came around. That's when women now had a choice. Yeah. And before that, basically marriage meant pregnancy and that made it impossible. And from an industrial point of view, it's probably not safe for a lot of those situations as well.
And the other point is that from what we're learning now, men who have important positions in companies and the women who work for them, that having an unmarried woman as your secretary made it easier for you to exploit them and not get in trouble maybe for a vengeful husband.
Interesting.
But I think it's important to note too, though, that I read an article the other day, and I am fairly sure that it was the National Gallery of Art in Washington that has 8% of what they're showing female artists.
Yes.
8%. So 92% of what they're showing as, you know, wonderful art in the Americas is male's art.
And that's in 2020.
Right. Yeah. Your question, you know, you said, has things actually improved substantially? I would say, I don't know if they've improved, but I certainly wouldn't say substantially.
I agree. How about look at the money that women make in comparison to what men make still today?
Yep, exactly.
100 years later.
And I was even thinking of the book that we read several months ago about Ruth Ozawa and how originally everybody looked at her as arts and craft, and her fabulous, beautiful, you know, sculptures were looked as arts and crafts. And it took her many, many years to have her work sold and sold in New York and sold at Sotheby's. So no, women, but it was especially difficult in those times because they couldn't even work. And I agree with you about how they had to fight just to work, not even be represented by the union. And that was even brought up in the little video. They said, oh, they liked the women because they had little delicate fingers. They also liked the women because they didn't have to pay them as much.
That's right.
Good one, Barbara.
Delicate fingers. They didn't have to pay them quite as much as they had to pay the men. So. Yep.
One of the things I would contribute here is we've been talking about Clara and her group of women, but those immigrant women, what an incredibly difficult challenge for them to ever get out from under where they were.
Yeah.
Some of the scenes with her going over to visit, I can't remember the woman's name, but where her mother was so
Wilhelmina,
right. And it was just devastating to hear the descriptions and how those women were treated, both she, her mother, what a challenge for them. It was certainly for Clara, but she did have a strong background where her parents were educated, they were ministers, they were involved in their community in a real positive manner. Those immigrants really had no role model, and what a gift Clara gave to them to support them as much as she did.
Yes, but she was also she was disappointed when they had to leave, when they would get engaged or they would get married and they would leave and they wouldn't be able to follow their talent. So many of them had talent, and she was heartbroken when they had to leave. And it was similar for herself in her own personal life. But I think we get to that later on. So in that one, how did Clara manage to fit in the mold? How did she manage to continue to work?
Well, she stayed unmarried.
Right. Yeah, that helped.
Well, I also think she developed a personal relationship with Tiffany. I think he respected her, and I think that helped. If she hadn't had that direct contact, like some of the other women that worked for her who didn't have that direct contact with him, she may not have been as successful.
Yeah. And at least according to the book and the way the story is told, she knew the rules, and she knew how to work within the rules, yet still express herself.
Right. I think Jackie had something to say.
Yeah, she was a workaholic, number one. And then living in that house, what did they use the word for the house? The
boarding
house. The boarding house, right. And the boarding house became the surrogate family. But I think the way she survived was she was a workaholic and didn't look for that much diversion. Did get it ultimately, but her work ethic was so extreme.
Once again, I take that back to the role of women in society and culture at that time. I mean, there weren't a lot of choices. And so, I mean, she was very fortunate to find that niche, I think.
It seemed like she really loved what she was doing. I mean, she really had that passion for art. She was a true artist, the way that I understood the book. And so I think that passion also, I don't think it was really like a job for her. I think that was really her life, her passion.
Yes, I think so. And I think that Susan Greenland also talked about her love of nature when she was sick and ill. And I think she communicated that through her characters in the book. And I'm sure there's an article that I asked Christy, maybe she'll send it out to you afterwards or send you the link. It's about the Tiffany girls. But Clara, when she went to school, was very involved in nature and art. She went to the Cleveland Art Institute, and then she went to the Metropolitan museum, well, the Metropolitan, it wasn't called the Museum School, but it was called the Metropolitan School of Art. And so she was always interested in art. And I think after her relationship with Edwin, she really did throw herself into her work because I think it was her passion. I think mm-hmm. she was very, she might have drawn at home. Like, I think there was one book where they said that women should go to these schools of art so they'd have something to do, like make nice some little handicrafts around
when there. When their embroidery thread gave out.
I think you had your hand up. Pat or Mike?
Oh, yeah, I was just going to reiterate what's actually already been said, basically, while I was waiting. But I do think it was clearly, she was a workaholic, you know, which all artists have to be. Because, you know, if you don't work, you don't create. But I think it went well beyond that on it. I thought she was an interesting character. And the question that I have, and I don't know the extent of the relationship that she had with Tiffany. Does anyone know how influential was he? Because in the book, it just sort of like said that he would just kind of, I got the impression, just come in and make a few comments to legitimize his position. And so I just was wondering, because I don't know that much about Tiffany. And so,
well, from what I've read, Tiffany was extremely talented himself. He did paint and he was involved. I was kind of thinking that he was kind of like a Steve Jobs kind of guy. He had
Chihuly kind of guy.
Yeah, like where he had, yes, where he had many, many ideas and he showed everything at the World's Fairs and things in his name. And it was very unusual for Claire to get any kind of acclaim from her lamp. So I thought of him kind of like, he did have talent and he knew how to bring people together and he did have a creative arts. I don't know as much about him as I'd like to, and maybe that's something I would pursue further, but I think he was artistic himself and I think he did collaborate not only with her, but he collaborated with Candace Wheeler, who was who went to Boston and became, I forgot the name of her group that she, it was an association of arts and crafts women. But he did work with many other people. He was, that's why I say he's a Steve Jobs kind of guy. He got ideas from people, but he also had the gift to put it all together.
Barbara, I think that that's a marvelous analogy, and I'm so glad that you brought that up, because if you think of, you know, Tiffany equivalent to Steve Jobs and Apple to Tiffany Studios, not Tiffany and Company, because Tiffany and Company was his father's jewelry business. I think that that's really great, because you have those really talented people that are working for you, but ultimately they as individuals sort of fade into the background to the glory of the company. That's great. Thank you for saying that. Can I just make a suggestion? Can we, in order to get the questions off the screen so that we can see each other, can we just sort of very quickly go through the questions so that everybody sees them and has them in their minds, but then I can turn them off so that we can see each other?
Sure.
Okay, great. So I've got question three, and these are just guiding questions, things to think about and to sort of direct our conversation, but we are in no way married to them. How does New York City come across in the book? Does it become another character? Why or why not? I think that's a great question, Barbara. What did you think of life in Clara's boarding house? Do you agree with George, who said she moved into Bohemia? What are some of the social contrasts in the book? How do these contrasts shape Clara's character? In what ways was Clara a progressive woman? How did politics affect her life? How is the Brooklyn Bridge an icon or symbol of the time? What were other iconic places and objects of the Gilded Age? How do you define a tragic character? Would you characterize George or Edwin or Wilhelmina as tragic? And what did you learn about Tiffany, his legacy, his business, or his style? Back to you, Barbara.
Okay.
This way we can all see each other bigger. We're not looking and trying to find each other on the screen.
I do have them here and I could read them if we run out of things to talk about. And I also have a few other questions if we run out of things to talk about. But okay, Billy, is there something you wanted to comment? I can't hear you.
Oh, you're not mute. You're muted.
You're muted.
I would disagree. I would not call her a workaholic. I would agree with whoever said she was an artist, because the people I know who are truly artists, that's what they do. That's how they think. That's what they do. That's how they live. And so I think that her circumstances, certainly, because she had lost a husband and all of these other things, but I wouldn't call her a workaholic. I would just call her a really devoted artist.
Yes?
I wanted to talk to New York City. Being an ex-New Yorker. Am I okay, Barbara?
Yeah, I just don't see everybody's name anymore. I don't know why. Oh, now I see it. Okay.
Oh, okay. So at one point in the book, they referred to a Mayor Van Wyck, and I lived in Queens at the Van Wyck station on the E train, the Independent line. And I always thought my station was named after the road rather than a person. So, and then we had Van Wyck Junior High School. Yes, it was a very important, lively thing for me to, and I know about the Flatiron Building and a lot of the places that were identified. So it was like, it was a living book for me, even though it was historical.
Yes, Pat.
Actually, it's Mike, but anyway, the other part, during that time period in New York particularly, there was a very large labor movement, mostly organized by immigrants.
Yeah.
You know, the men and ladies garment industries organized. And so that I think a large part of the book, which kind of I enjoyed reading, since as Christy says, I'm not allowed to say anymore. But I'm not an artist, but I really enjoy reading these books, is that there was a lot about the labor movement and the solidarity among the women and the men not liking the women's movement, but she didn't put anything in about what was going on around that time in terms of particularly organizing women who worked in the garment industry.
I don't know whether I read it in the book, but they talked about, when she talked to them, there was about a cap company, and she talked about some women. She did talk about Emma Goldman, and she talked about some other woman. I forgot the name of the woman, but she did talk about them organizing. And when she was trying to motivate the Tiffany girls, she brought this woman up and said that, she said, just look inside your skirts and you'll see the ACLU label inside your skirts.
Yeah.
So it wasn't a primary thing, and her demonstration wasn't a union demonstration, but I think they were frightened to even try to unionize because they were such a small part of that company. Yes, Sharon?
Do I remember in the book correctly that the women crossed the men's picket line or strike line or whatever and went into work when they wouldn't perform at work because they were in a union? Of course, the women were not allowed in the union, so the women who wanted to get paid were crossing the line. Mm-hmm. I don't know what anybody made of that. I thought that was a very dangerous thing to do, number one, and, very, very, yeah, brave.
Brave.
And, yeah, and brave. This was really the foundation of suffrage, of women's suffrage.
Oh, I mean, really?
This is where all of that movement came together.
It was starting at that time. And I think that women were starting to come out of of
servitude.
To the church themselves. So I think it was the beginning of the, actually this book I was asked for my one of my book clubs, that's why I thought of it for this one. But we were talking about the 2020 being the year that women got the vote, and they wanted, we were all going to recommend books about women who made a difference. And I think Clara in a small way did make a difference because she was a woman in the mm-hmm. arts. I hope you all will read the article. She didn't come to light until just recently. She wrote these round robin letters, which came to light in, I think, maybe 2007 or so. And they found out that she had developed the lamp. And so after all those years of not having very much notoriety, right. or really no, I think the Cleveland School did mention her because they knew about it and she was from Cleveland, but it's just become more widespread, the knowledge about Clara. So
I love the scene that Sharon, that you brought up, the scene of the women sort of organizing and crossing the picket line. And I actually didn't read the book. I listened to it, the audiobook. And I was thinking as I was listening, this scene is going on forever. She's putting so much, you know, time and pages into this mm-hmm. scene. And then I started to reflect on just sort of the importance of it. And it made sense that it was sort of a long scene that she, I thought the level of detail that the author went to during that scene made it come alive for me. By the time these women were actually walking down the street and got to the men, I was terrified for them. But okay. that, you know, she walked us through, you know, to this level of detail of, you know, every single woman in her studio having to make that decision and what mm-hmm. were the things that each one was mm-hmm. weighing. And then she talks about, you know, them meeting and, you know, where they were coming from and telling them to bring your lunch so that we don't have to go outside, and make sure that you put it in a cloth bag and tie it around your waist because you're going to need both hands. And, you know, she really sort of thought through every detail and the way that they felt and sort of the sights and the sounds to really make that scene, I think, come alive for us as readers, and the importance of, you know, these women, and, you know, that it was small scenes like this or small moments like this that really started to make a difference. And Tim, I had wondered about the Triangle Fire, and Tim, you pointed out in the chat that it was in 1911. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Well, I think there are probably several people here who can talk in more detail about it, but just because I did not read the book, I am so embarrassed. I did not read the book. What year was that set?
It was earlier. It was
1890s.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, right. 1900s.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we know a couple of things that happened. My other question had to do with these World's Fairs, the expositions of that era, and not just the Chicago one, but there were others before and after, and I know that this Tiffany was very active as much as he could, as somebody who understood publicity and knew that that was the best internet there was at the time. But at the same time, I also wonder, you know, what else there was going on at that time that would influence the direction? Because we know that, you know, with the lack of communication, big cities were kind of worlds unto themselves, especially New York, as it continues to try to be. So I was wondering how many other of these things were kind of setups for that sort of prepared everybody for changes that happened in 1911 after the fire, or in response to the fire, and I wonder how it changed. We know that at about that time there were a lot of women. I was thinking about in New Orleans making pottery and designing pottery under their own names. at the Newcomb Pottery. And that seems to be an interesting way of, because that's sort of that same era or leading into that era in any case. Yes, so that's very confusing, isn't it?
Well, I'm not sure what the expositions did for women. There were some women who contributed, but not many, very few.
Michelle?
Yeah, I just wanted to clarify because it's just because I've gone to quite a few events in the last year because of the 100th anniversary of the women's vote, right to vote, that women's suffrage actually started in 1848 in Seneca, New York, with Emily Lamott and Katie Stanton.
Yes.
So, I mean, it certainly did come to a head in the Gilded Age in the 20s, and that's when they were, you know, really organizing. But suffrage started, and not only in New York, it was also started first in London, actually. Women's suffrage began there. So I just wanted to clarify that point.
Part of that was my point in that suffrage movements had been going on for a while. And so that's why I was wondering whether the expositions were in some way an advantage. Were there other things that were going on behind the scenes there, maybe that gave the suffrage movement a boost in some form? Was there any kind of organizing around it or related to it? And certainly in the 98, I suspect was probably not much, but later some of the others were, you know, had potential anyway.
I think that they were more mutually exclusive, pretty much. However, that said, at the Chicago World's Fair, they did look to, did they actually have the women's building, or did they look to create it and it didn't happen? Something like that.
They had a women's building.
They did have a women's building.
Yes, I think so.
Yeah.
I have to look it up in my, but I think they did. But I think a lot of people in the suffrage movement, it was kind of like you didn't want to get associated with it. It was like kind of in the dark. I don't think a lot of people came out for it. They were like closet suffragettes. I don't think Clara, in her heart, the way she acted was a suffragette, but she wouldn't probably align herself with that movement.
Shall I don't you? Think that the vote had any place in this book at all.
No, it didn't. I don't think so.
I don't recall that being an issue. It was more sort of day-to-day living, the right to work and the plight of the poor and immigrants. Sharon, you've had your hand up. You're muted.
Maybe you could use spelling.
Unmute. How am I doing?
Yes, no? We hear you.
Oh, okay. Yeah, during that time, I know it was a very long time. Women were looking for getting the vote and certainly for the ability to hold a job on your own. And somebody mentioned the Shirt House Fire. And I think things like that, it was a very dramatic incident in the early 1900s, I guess somebody said 1911 or whatever. And Cynthia Drew wrote a wonderful book on just that very event, where women who were working in a five-story or seven-story high building in New York City, when the building caught on fire, it was found that they were locked in so that they all burned to death inside of their workplace. And because stories like that were very dramatic at the time, I think that the women's movement, and I think Barbara, you're right, it was dangerous actually to come out and say, if your husband didn't beat you at home, you were the paraded women that were going down the streets trying to get the vote were not only heckled, but things thrown at them and really disastrous things happening to them when they were arrested in jail and whatever. So I think that there was a lot going on at that time. Somebody mentioned that, you know, all the background wasn't there. I think Mike said there was a great deal of background that wasn't given in the book about unions forming at that time and women trying to come out at that time and gain independence. there was just a lot to it. And I think that, I don't know if we can have an appreciation for all of that, but it was certainly a very dramatic time and a difficult time for a lot of women. And
yeah, I was just going to say that, and Christy sort of started touching on this. As I rethink the book, a lot of the focus on the women in the workshop was the loss of them not being able to be artists.
Right. I agree with that.
And I think that was the real tragedy of this, you know, the focus of the book.
Actually. Right. I think there is a lot of... Yes, I agree with you. I think that my feeling about the book too was that it was Claire as an artist and a woman as an artist. I'm sorry I interrupted you. I hope you just have something else to say, Pat.
No, I'm good.
She's used to me interrupting her. What I wanted, I thought, you know, the whole business about that, walking through the picket line, to me, when I read that book, I felt a great deal of respect among the women for each other, but also the tension that was alluded to me didn't come through. I mean, certainly Tiffany was very respectful of the woman. He understood that without them, he couldn't produce what he wanted to produce. And I was impressed with the camaraderie among the people who worked in that factory. And there were a bunch of bad apples, like the guy who had his only interest was the bottom line. And then early on in that book, and I don't know, who was Comfort Tiffany?
That's the head guy of that, but he was the
So he's the one who they said basically sold rum to the Indians.
Know,
basically make back all the money he paid them.
I think that was Comfort Tiffany.
Yeah, that's what I meant, yeah.
Yeah.
Not Lewis Comfort.
Tiffany.
Grandfather. Right. Great-grandfather, I guess.
Grandfather, right. But I was very sympathetic to Tiffany in this book. And I felt he had a hand in all the art that was created. And I think the author gave him a lot of credit for allowing the women to produce what they wanted.
I had faith in them.
I agree. She did write him, I think, as sympathetic. What did you call a tragic character? Is what you had said, Barbara, although you didn't put him in your list of possible tragic characters, but she really wrote him, and I just don't know enough about him to know whether or not this is accurate or not, but as the dreamer, as the idea person, not as the one who was, you know, concerned with business or logistics or possibility or, you know, any of the sort of reality needed to run a successful business. But I felt that there were also some things that she wrote about him that made him not a sympathetic character. The way that he treated his daughters was sort of different from the way he treated his female workers. You know, he really supported his female workers and had, you know, tried to give them within the possibilities of the time, the opportunities that he could, yet he wouldn't allow his daughters to go to college because I think that meant leaving him, right?
He also saw them, I thought, as a means to an end. I think that maybe his respect for Clara's talent predominated in the book, but I don't think that he had a grand. And even when she came back and wanted to marry Edwin, he was just completely inflexible. No, you can't be married and work here. So how much appreciation he really had for them, I would question. An egoist is how he was referred to.
Yeah.
I really like this book because it had a lot of components in it about the bohemia, like living in the boarding house, and the gay.
All the gay men, yes.
And her attitude towards them. I thought that was extremely interesting, and just her where she lived, and it felt like it was the beginning of like Greenwich Village or the beginning of the art of New York City. I enjoy that part of the book.
I'm glad you brought that up, because that wasn't in your questions. I was really moved by her portrayal of the homosexual characters in this book, and think that they actually, all of them in their own way, played a really important role in the book. And there were the women and the homosexual men that I felt such compassion for, because they, you know, both groups were in sort of the way that she wrote it, a very impossible situation that I think was very true to life. And certainly that situation for many people still hasn't even changed. So I love the fact that she made this, you know, small group of homosexual men so important in the book, and wrote them, I think, really beautifully.
Mm-hmm. Huh? I was just going to say that each of the characters that she introduced, she didn't spend a whole lot of time, like with the guy that was, I guess, deaf because they were spelling out the words. I mean, it was a well-developed character. You know, you had with just a little bit of information, you had a deep understanding. And then the gentleman that worked in the basement and was responsible for the glass, you know, the compassion that he had. I thought a lot of the characters were very well developed.
One of the things we didn't talk about, which I really got a lot from this book, is actually what went into making that glass. Wow. The different layers of glass. I never really knew that. Just the work and the, not only the talent, but the risk, like, you know, when you drop something and, you know, you have to start all over, or I just never realized that process was so complex. So I really learned a lot from just reading about that.
So you skipped over one of your questions and about Bohemia.
Yeah.
In the middle of the book, Pat said, could we move to that boarding house?
I thought it was
that sounded like such fun.
That's fun, and you were taken care of with your meals. You could come home in the middle of the day and have your lunch with the rest of your boarders. I did think the same thing, that it kind of sounds like it would be fun to live there.
I thought the same thing. Yes, Sharon.
All right, we'll all move to the kibbutz.
That would be great. A communal living. And I remember a friend of mine had said one time my daughter was doing she was going to New York for a while, and they had a house where young women could live. And it reminded me, and it also, I think it was near Gramercy Park. I wonder if it was from that era. But I think that was very common in that day and age, that people lived communally in those houses. But I agree with Jackie that I love New York. I love the first ride on the subway, and they went to the end of the line, and it was like just farms and snowmen. And I thought those parts of the book were pretty amazing. And I was even going to send you a picture of the Madison Square Garden there that they talked about, that they went to for New Year's Eve, that it was this building that they tore down in 1926, but it was built by Tiffany and had glass and gas and all kinds of things coming out of it on New Year's. Wow. I thought that was really interesting. So I do think New York was also a character in the book.
To get to your first question about the Gilded Age and sort of the mores of the Gilded Age, I started to get really frustrated about halfway through the book when it was evident that she and, was his name Bernard in the book, the man that became her third husband, that, you know, they've lived together for a dozen years, but she's never asked him if he was married, you know? But I thought that was interesting, because she sort of did have that self-awareness when they were finally sort of revealing themselves to one another, that she didn't ask, or maybe hadn't been motivated to ask, because if she had asked and made her intentions known much earlier, it would have meant a big, she would have had to leave her job if, you know, something had happened. And so both of them lived in this sort of state of not knowing what their intentions were for so long, because he respected what she did and her passion for her work, and didn't want to have to put her in a position where she had to make that choice. And then when they finally did sort of declare themselves to one another, and she decided, you know, after the day after George dies, to go to work, and he takes that as a rejection and sort of leaves town, I thought, oh gosh, this woman has no luck with men. You know, this is the third time that she's going to be sort of thrown over. But luckily the author didn't draw that out too much and let them get together the next day.
Barbara, is it correct that she in fact went on to paint silk scarves and never went back to
any of them available? But Hazel wanted to say something. She hasn't said anything, so I want to give her.
Thank you. Yes, I have a question about the book, which I did not read. Was the company making lamps prior to the incandescent light bulb?
Yes.
They were? Mm-hmm. And then what was the light source?
Gas?
Oil.
Oil. Okay.
In fact, she started with oil lamps, and then later they
went to the
electric light. I think that there was a point, Hazel, at which they first started to design the lamps, where she was cognizant of the fact that the base needed to hold the oil. So that's why they had sort of the mosaic bottom rather than the metal bottom that we might be used to looking at. And then they moved to sort of a period where they would make some oil, but some electric. And then, of course, as more people got electricity, I think they went all electric. So they went through a stage. But that's why the bases might look different if you're looking at antique Tiffany lamps, for you to be able to know when they were made because of what was powering the light. As always happens, it's already past one. Book, Barbara, I think you hit on a good one. It was both, I think, a really good story, a really interesting look at history, but also a really fascinating deep dive into glassmaking and decorative arts, and women in the arts. So it hit on a lot of points. So Barbara, thank you so much for choosing a really good selection. Barbara had mentioned several points during our conversation today that there was this article, and I'd be happy to send this in my follow-up evaluation email, but also I wanted to sort of give you the title and the year so that if you wanted to look it up yourself, you could. And this article, I believe, was published at the same time that exhibition that Barbara showed us from New Mexico at the beginning was going around. There was a lot of interest in sort of the Tiffany girls and Clara Driscoll. So this article provides that historical background, the real story, as it were, sort of behind Susan Vreeland's book. So I would encourage you to look at it. I didn't want to send it out beforehand because, as Barbara said, it had spoilers. And that way, now after we've had our discussion, you can go in and, if you're interested, read some more about the history behind the book.
And also, when I was doing a little research, Agatha Northrup, who was the first woman designer of the Tiffany windows, I don't know if it's still on, and I know we don't want to go in COVID, but at Rinalda House, they had a showing of some of her glass windows. So,
And lamps.
Okay.
And Susan Vreeland is a lovely author, and I recommend reading the Boathouse book and the one about the good woman in the blue hyacinth. That she's a good author. You'll love her.
We have read several of her novels over the years in this group. I believe the last time we read of her fiction was, I think we read Life Studies, which is a collection of short stories a couple of years ago. Some of you might remember. I did want to mention that we have posted on our website the next two books for Discussion Bound. In January, January 12th, we will be discussing The Photograph as Contemporary Art by Charlotte Cotton. This is the fourth edition of a survey book looking at contemporary photography as art. Some of the photographers that are highlighted throughout the book will be featured in our exhibition that opens next week, right, called Vantage Points, Contemporary Photography from the Whitney Museum of American Art. I see Doris is very excited about that exhibition. We had our docent training for it yesterday and has really amazing photographs. So I wanted to have a selection that highlighted photography as art and to expose us to some of the photographers in that exhibition a little bit more in depth so that we can consider their work. In February, on February 9th, we'll be reading Hidden in Plain View, A Secret Story of Quilts and the Underground Railroad by Jacqueline Tobin and Raymond DeBard, which talks about the language of quilts and the way that quilts were used in the 19th century in order to guide enslaved people to freedom. So those are the two books. More information is posted on our website. As always, please consider supporting your local bookseller. Malaprop's Bookstore and Cafe in downtown Asheville will have those books on their shelves. And if you mention that you're getting them from Discussion Bound, they will offer you a 10% discount. I hope that everyone has a great week. Thank you again, Barbara. Great discussion. Appreciate you. I hope everyone has a good holiday season, and we'll see you again in the new year. Take care.
It was wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you. It was great.
Thank you for coming. Bye.